Hey everyone, it's Andy Kushner with The Wedding Biz, in which I conduct in-depth and revealing interviews of icons of the weddings and event industry. All this is to provide education and inspiration for any entrepreneur, particularly in the event industry. And today's conversation is yet another of my favorites. And before I introduce our special guest, I want to mention that last episode on October 21st was with designer-planner David Stark. Another great interview. So, today's is an amazing below-the-surface interview with designer-planner Brian Rafanelli, founder and chief creative officer of Rafanelli Events. Brian was named one of the top wedding planners by Harper's Bazaar, Martha Stewart Weddings, Departures, and was named Man of the Moment by Town & Country. Rafanelli Events has been highlighted in numerous publications, including the New York Times, Wall Street Journal, and People Magazine. Notably, Brian and his team led the concept and design of Chelsea Clinton's wedding, many of President Obama's White House state dinners and events, and most recently, several campaign events for Vice President Kamala Harris. Enjoy this conversation with Brian Rafanelli. Hey, Brian, so good to have you back on the show. It has been a while. I've been excited about this, so thank you.
You're welcome. Excited to be here.
Yeah. So, you know, I'm on the music side of the industry, and national level artists talk about how hard it is to get to such a high level in their field, and it's even harder to stay there. And, you know, you've been designing and planning for a very long time. You know, you've been at a really high level for a very long time. Do you ever feel pressure, like, especially in this now highly saturated market, to keep innovating, you know, and not only that, but I wonder how you keep your passion up for it after all these decades.
Wow, this is a loaded question.
I know that you can handle it. I'm diving right in. We don't do this surface bullshit.
Look, I have this line to my team that you're only as good as your last event. And I've lived by that for a very, very long time. And so I still do that. So the answer is yes. this is complicated and I think about it every day. But at the same time, it has been in my DNA to want to focus on the event at hand and then look at the next one with the same kind of energy and enthusiasm and innovation for sure. Although I despise trends. So it's really not about that. It's just making some awesome connection or finding some amazing entertainment or some, strange art form that nobody's ever seen before. That those things are always fantastic, but not if they don't connect to the story of the event. So I will not, I don't fall victim to artistic successes just because there's something new. It's a lot more about, does it connect? And when people walk away, do they say, oh my gosh, that was really good. I've never seen something like that before, but wow, that was really about the host or the theme or the nonprofit or whatever, I'm working on.
But do you also, this is also my personal interest. I've been doing this for decades and I have moments where I'm feeling really burnt out. But then I think, what the hell else am I going to do? This is how I express myself creatively. You know what I mean? I mean, do you go through periods of that? How do you deal with that?
I do go through periods of that, but I'm careful, honestly, Andy. I have a great life. And to me, if I have that itch to wonder if I can keep doing this or should I keep doing this, I reflect on the great opportunities I've had and seek out. So this is what I'm going to say, seek out a different kind of experience, probably within the realm of designing a wedding or planning a wedding or an amazing event. But I'm pretty comfortable with that. The idea that this is, where I am supposed to be. And I'm open to the universe presenting something different for me, but I don't automatically be like, oh my God, I've done this for too long. I have to do something else. I'm not that guy.
Do you have ways, just in your personal life away from designing for an event, do you have ways of being creative that fulfill you?
I guess because I'm having trouble answering that question. I don't have like an amazing, passion for acrylic painting or drawing or singing or anything like that. So I don't have the other. I have like healthy other things, but not necessarily in the creative realm.
Yeah. It's just, I mean, because like for myself, but people have hobbies. I have almost no hobbies.
No hobbies here.
Yeah. Right.
Unless you want to call politics a hobby, which sometimes I think it is a hobby, but I have other passions, but I don't necessarily in the creative field. Although saying it to you, I am a creative thinker and I want to be around creative thinkers, right? So that's what drives. I can't help be at a dinner party or listen to my nieces and nephews or a friend and they're trying to solve something and my mind immediately gets creative. Like, well, did you think about this? Did you think about that? What if you did this? What if you did that? That for sure. That's not a hobby. That's just life. But I look for those crack of the bat moments where I know that even, again, if I'm with a person who's asking me what they should do, you know, to raise more money for their nonprofit or tell their story or whatever it may be, and I start to, you know, spitball ideas, and then I feel something, like I feel that sort of energy that I feel when I'm designing a party, right? Or I'm, looking at a challenge for a wedding that seems impossible to make it possible. That electricity happens. And so when that happens in my life in every category, that's when I know I'm absolutely where I'm supposed to be.
Yeah, I love that. You know, I'm also thinking that I remember that first time I interviewed you, and for people listening, it was episode 84. And it was really a wonderful conversation. And I had asked how you balance the artistic side with the business side of what you do, with being successful. Because obviously, as you know, we can be a brilliant genius designer or whatever we do in this business, but if we don't have a handle on the business side, it's not going to manifest, you know, in a way that can pay our way and all of that. And so I remember what you said. You said, and it really helped change me in a way, you said that you actually love the business aspect. And that at the time when I asked that, I really hated the business aspect. It's one of the reasons I got a business partner 6 years ago, and it's been wonderful. I now mostly do the creative because I always had trouble, you know, actually balancing that. And when you said that, it struck me. And so it's been many years. Do you still feel the same? How do you feel about the business aspect of what you do?
I definitely feel the same, and I guess I've neutralized it. And what that means is I want both to be excellent and superior, and so that's what I strive for every single day. And believe me, on some days when I'm the creative director of my company, so I am looking at, you know, design after design after design, and that can be incredibly exciting but amazingly tedious. Or the same thing of like looking at my company, our profit margins, you know, how every element of what we're putting forward is working and is it meeting our standards? That also can be incredibly tedious, or it can be incredibly exciting. Like, we're up 17% this year. That is very exciting. On the creative side, we have done some of the most incredible creative projects in the history of our company. That's also very exciting. So I'm constantly trying to not make one more important than the other, because I think that's the trap. I think the trap is, I don't love business. Well, you know what? Look, people who are like, I want to have an amazing body and I want to live till I'm 110, but I don't like to work out and eat healthy.
Right.
Like, that doesn't make sense. Like, you can't have it that way. So you have to find a path to liking and enjoying both. Or it's just, it could be really painful. and why do it then?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. I mean... Like I say, long ago when I interviewed you, I really was not enjoying the business aspect, and I started to look at it more as a kind of a creative act. You know, why not apply creativity to the business of it? And in that sense, I can enjoy it and use the facilities that I have to take it to another level.
And look, I guess for your listeners, because I just heard you say something, I don't, and I'm not saying you're saying this, but the magic bullet isn't always like, I have, like, Marcy Bloom will always say to me, I need a Deborah Farley. So Deborah Farley is my president, right? She's amazing. She's been with me, she's a consultant for 6 years and then has been with the company probably 11 or 12 full time. Yes, I have an amazing leader that I can rely on, but it's not the only answer. It's not like I can't look at the business. Like, yes, you can seek out a business partner or a creative partner. But at the end of the day, I really believe you have to be in touch with both. Because if you're not, one could go wrong without you knowing it. And that's in business, that's a really bad thing. So if our creative gets bad, it's not good. That's not good for Rafanelli, right? If our business, if our profit margins go down, we're not, you know, keeping up, then that's not good for business, especially long term. And so you just have to find a path and rely on really amazing people around you, but you must be in touch with it.
You know, also, I wonder what the hard part of this is for you. Like in other words, I know, you know, a lot of people listening are going to think, oh, Brian Rafanelli at this level that he's been and the kind of events that he does, he's arrived, you know, he knows what, it's all easy now, everything's wonderful. And, you know, we know that we all, as artists and business people, go through struggles at times. And so I'm wondering for you, what is the hard part in it? What are the challenges that you're facing? What's the latest for you? Yeah, I'm going in.
No, it's a great question because I joke all the time that I'm going to write a book about the other side of success.
Yes. That's a great title too.
That's the answer, right? That's the answer to your question is like, yeah, you know what? I get so frustrated because people project who I am, what I think about, what I think success is. Oh, or I love it when they're like, oh, you're just turning away business. I mean, you don't need business. Like I had somebody say, oh, I didn't call you for my daughter's wedding because you don't need my business. I'm like, wait, what? Like, no. Like, and that's the other side. That's the really challenging side of this, of saying, no, actually, I want to consider every piece of business. I want that opportunity. And when I don't get it, it really bums me out. Because why? Because of how successful we are, what a great job we do. And that, you know, look, this is a very good analogy to the fashion business, right? You know, if Gucci sends down the most amazing collection for spring 2025 and everybody's lauding them, they have to create another collection, right?
Yeah.
And you're only as good as your last event. And that is the thing that I look at all the time. And then also building great people. Like I want great people around me all the time, but I say it all the time. This is not a life sentence at Rafanelli. So if somebody is going to dedicate themselves to Rafanelli for 3 to 5 years professionally and then decide to move on, I am so excited by that. I'm not disappointed. I'm like, great. But one of the challenges, Andy, is now I have to start over.
Yeah,
right?
Retrain someone.
We have to start over again and train people up and get them to fall in love with the business and give them lots of opportunity and the opportunity to work hard and thrive. And then guess what? They decide that maybe they want to move on or actually they want to stay. I mean, over 60% of my employees at this moment have been with me 8 to 15 years. That's extraordinary, right? Now I have to keep the machine going, right? I have to make it an exciting place to work. I have to, you know, with my team, we have to do that. And those are the things that you imagine when you're, you know, in the business in the beginning, or let's say you're 5 to 7 years in the business, and you know the way you grow is by doing more events. That's a fact. You know that has to happen. So that means more labor, more teams. That is a constant challenge, and it's something I definitely struggle with every single day to keep up with that and to keep up with our reputation, right? The reputation that we've created. We have to hold ourselves to these standards that we created, and that can be very difficult.
Yeah, definitely. I've been asked where I gain the inspiration and expertise to host this show, The Wedding Biz, and it all comes from my own experience in the weddings and event industry of creating world-class entertainment to support our custom entertainment design. Kushner Entertainment features outrageously dynamic bands, strings, and a host of other entertainment acts that have won numerous international, national, and local to the Washington, D.C. area awards. Not only for individual acts, such as the band Sound Connection, but also for our highly engaging and captivating entertainment design concepts. Go to KushnerEntertainment.com to learn more about the ultimate in event entertainment. That's KushnerEntertainment.com. Earlier, you mentioned that you know this year or in the past year, you've done some creative projects that are you know some of the most wonderful ones you've done. What else? What do you dream about, Brian? Like, what have you not done that you would love to do?
This question is so hard for me.
Oh, good.
it's hard because I'm choking on dessert. you know, that's what's hard. I've done like Super Bowl celebrations and state dinners at the White House and Academy Award, Tony Award winning, Grammy Award winning, you know, clients that are super imaginative and so open to exciting ideas. So I honestly, Andy, I don't sit back and say, oh, I'd love to do the opening of the Olympics, or I'd love to do the Elton John dinner after the Oscars, right? Although I'm identifying those events for you, I wouldn't turn them away.
Right.
I don't have my eye on one specific experience, like an event per se. But I will tell you that I am constantly hungry for the next great challenge. Mm. Like the thing, if you tell me, we have one coming down the pike that I can't tell you about yet, but when it hits the news, it's going to be like once in a lifetime. This is historic. This has never happened before. Like those are all my elixirs. Like those things get me so excited. If you say we can't do this, it's impossible, then I want to make it possible. And so those are the things that I want to do. That's exactly what I'm going to do. That's the next challenge. I don't, you know, in this case, I know exactly what it is, but next year, I'm not sure what that is. But I can say it out loud to you, right? I can imagine that the next thing will come down the pike that is really insanely challenging. And it will press every button in my head, in my body, in my heart, and my team's looking at me like, Brian, come on, how could we possibly do this? But we've managed to do it. And that's exciting.
You know, it's interesting. Part of me wants to just kind of relax and hang out, chill out. You know, I've been doing it a long time, getting older. But when that happens, if I'm not feeling creatively challenged, I am bored as hell, you know, and get irritable. And I need to have challenges. It's just how I'm wired. I think probably a lot of us creatives are wired that way.
Yeah. So I'm curious if you've thought about this. I definitely have thought about, and I think it's particular to, you know, when some terrible thing happens, when you lose a friend unexpectedly or a family member, or you're kind of like, oh my God, you know, what am I doing? Like, should I just stop? And should I just take the next 20 years or 30 years of my life and just chill out and go to boot camp and hang out with my dogs and spend time at my beautiful house on the beach? And those are all amazing choices. But I'm not there yet. I'm worried that I'm going to do that. And then I'm going to end up like, you know, joining some initiative and trying to change the world where I am. Right. And that's the same thing I'm doing right now in my business. Like, what, why would I do that? I have so much trouble with that. And so therefore, you know, I know what I want to do. I am not shaming anybody who decides to retire at 50 or 60, but I don't see it.
Yeah. No, I get it. Although I am spending more time taking breaks, going to the mountains, going to the ocean. And, you know, it's also so refueling. And I think there's something to that.
Well, but that's a different, that is very different. You know, that is smart business, right? And smart personal business of saying, I am dancing as fast as I can. I'm traveling. I'm doing this. I'm doing that. Look, let me tell you, Andy, I got this down. Like, I don't go to a city. I'm going to be in four cities this week that I do not identify a trainer that I am working out with at 7 o'clock in the morning. I don't give up. You know, I love to exercise, so I don't give that up. I like to meditate. I don't give that up. I love music. I love to walk in a city. Like, I make time for that because that fills my heart and my mind, right? Now, the other hand is, yeah, you know, when I say, okay, I'm going to take a break, and then suddenly I have some amazing opportunity to go, you know, on to X country or whatever to do, and being invited by somebody or whatever it may be, which happens all the time in our industry, I'm like, yeah, I want to do that. So do I give up time? Sure, I do. I'm not really perfect at protecting my time, but I'm definitely good at protecting the things that I know are going to make me happy in the moment.
Yes. You know, before we go, a couple more questions. So you mentioned, and again, in this interview, you know, about some of the creative projects you've done, you've been so excited about. And in that first interview that we had, You told me about an event you designed that had never been done before and could never be done again. The one on the barge. Remember that one? The barge?
Yeah, sure.
That was such a great story. Yeah.
Yeah.
Can you tell me the story of another event you designed that was really satisfying like that one, you know, maybe without revealing who the client is or whatever, but, you know, it was such a great story you told, and I know you have a million others.
Well, I guess what I would, but the story I'm going to tell you right now is just all about, it sounds so bizarre, but all around weather. What I've learned since the last time I talked to you is that I have the imagination and the wherewithal to come up with strategies to make whatever happens at a wedding, whether it's pouring rain, hail, hurricane. I got married in a hurricane.
Oh, come on.
You know, we have mastered how to figure this out. So therefore, we can set up two sites. Now, your listeners are going to be like, what, are you crazy? But we talk about this all the time. I was just out on this horse farm, and I'm like, well, over here will be the beautiful version, and over here will be the weather version. Both will be spectacular, and we will take away all of the anxiety of which one is going to happen. Now, does that take an investment? Of course it does. But what's the value of your mental fitness to decide, you know, what the best choice is? And on this side of my business, I'm doing that more and more and more so that people really can see both. And by the way, Andy, sometimes when I present to like the parents of the bride, they'll be like, we love the rain plan. Let's just go with
that. Wow, that's great.
Right? Yeah. So isn't that great? I mean, that's pretty awesome that you suddenly have come up with a solution that was just for the bad things that happened, and it actually turned out to be the best choice. That is, you know, to me, that's playing a little with the gods, right? Of like saying, well, you know, nothing is perfect and nothing's guaranteed. Well, sometimes it is. I mean, we can't make it, you know, we haven't perfected how to, you know, make rain go away with helicopters and all that. Apparently they do that in China all the time, but, you know, we haven't done that yet, but, you know, I do think we can reset your imagination of what success looks like on the day of your, you know, your daughter or your son's wedding, and wrap your hands around that. And I'm constantly trying to do that so that people don't fall into what's good and what's bad and what people tell you is what you hope for. And if you don't get that, it won't be great. We've had two rain weddings in the last 2 years in the same family, both daughters. It rained. If I showed you those photographs, you would completely fall in love. You would be like, holy moly. Like, that looks like the most beautiful wedding that I've ever been to. You know, that's really sort of the exciting part of imagining something that, you know, has it never been done before? I don't know. I think it's just thinking in a different way.
Can you give me some specifics of a story? You know, like when you did tell me the barge story, I would love to hear one.
Again, going through that Rolodex in my mind.
No, you've got 1,000 of them. Yeah.
I do have 1,000 of them. Well, look, I recently did a project where everything was going so well. In my business, glass top tents, or in our business, I should say, are so popular. And everybody dreams of a glass top tent. But the flaw in that, Andy, is if it's the weather suddenly turns to a 90 degree humid day, the glass top tent turns into a magnifying glass.
Oh, geez.
Right?
Right.
And it's horrible. And so in the moment, I'm constantly trying to figure out how to outsmart that. But we had covers on that tent, and one of the covers slipped off. And to reveal the sun, which cooked the tent.
Oh, no.
Now, this was all happening in real time, and everyone was panicking. And literally, guests were on, like, arriving to the site. Now, the solution was that it was really the weather gods that all of a sudden this cloud cover came over and cooled the whole area by 15 degrees. And we were saved. No one knew about that, right? No one knew that something like that, A, could happen, or B, could be solved in real time. And we were able to take a deep breath, figure out how we were going to conduct this. We were literally going to make my guys go back up onto the top of the tent and put the covers back on, right? Which would have been pretty ugly and kind of strange. But at the same time, you know, that part of the, you know, my world these days is really trying to come up with those solutions that end up being really positive and sometimes really charming. I kept on convincing my client that it was okay that we would have our tent guys crawling up on the tent and that guests were going to see that happen, but they were going to be grateful on the other side. That's part of the story, you know? And I know I'm like focusing on weather a lot, but you know, we live in a world, whether you believe in climate change or not, it's happening. And in the event world, it's probably the most terrifying thing that everybody has to deal with and come up with solutions in real time. And so we, in this earlier in this conversation, we were talking about these challenges or what challenges me, that kind of stuff really challenges me. You probably can hear it in my voice right now. It's like, that's what really gets me going of saying, you know, how can we solve this? Because we're in the business of making a happy ending, and every single time, knock on wood, it has worked out.
Right. Well, and at the time that we're recording this, there's, you know, a huge hurricane is about to hit for the second time in Florida, and you know, it's October, it's wedding season in a lot of places, and yeah, we got to deal with this. So lastly, what, you know, this is kind of similar to what we've been talking about, but what are you excited about that's coming up in the next year? Anything in particular or even generally speaking?
Well, I mean, I think you may know, or your listeners may know, that I'm pretty heavily involved in politics. And, you know, this is one of those moments where we're ending one experience and beginning another one. And so what happens in this election is actually going to greatly affect those kinds of experiences. So what I mean by that is that we're about to do the decorations at the White House for the last time for the Biden family and the country, but specifically for the Biden family. And that's pretty amazing, right? Of the end of an era. And quite frankly, it could be my last time designing Christmas at the White House. So there's that. And so, you know, now on the other hand, that opens up the possibility if we have our, you know, first woman president next year, that'll blow up my world for sure.
Right.
And there'll be all sorts of great opportunities to, entertain and, you know, show the world, who that person is and how they lead and how they celebrate the White House. So those are the things I'm really looking forward to, a little terrified, but, hopeful that it will all work out.
Yeah, I hear you. Believe me. I try not to say what I believe on the podcast, but and this is funny. This episode is going to be released on November 4th, the day before the election.
Holy shit.
And most people probably be listening to it that way. God knows. Anyway.
So I was just talking to my friend Michelle Rigo, who I know you've had on
sure.
before.
Oh, she's great.
You know, we are working on a project together before the election and she's like, I have this idea of creating survival kit for the election. And I'm like, I love it. I go, we need a stress ball. We need a Harris ball shot glass. We need little nips. Like it is, we definitely need a survival kit.
Yeah. yeah, there's so much I could want to say, but I'll hold back.
Yeah. Maybe you should.
Well, Brunt, this has been great. This has been great. I really appreciate you. You're willing to go deep and, I appreciate that very much. So this has really been a lot of fun. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. I really appreciate it.
Thank you for listening to my conversation with Brian Rafanelli. If you enjoyed this episode, please don't keep it to yourself. Be sure to tell a friend. You can check out his website, which is RafanelliEvents.com. You can find him on Instagram at RafanelliEvents. And next guest on November 18th is going to be planner designer Brooke Keegan. And finally, be sure to follow us on Instagram at The Wedding Biz, and we'll catch you in 2 weeks.